Good morning to all of you. Greetings to you all in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And this is the day that the Lord has made, and we shall all rejoice and be glad in it. And every day is a gift of God, and every time we come together and worship our living God, it's always a joy that we worship our God together. That brings a lot of joy in our heart. And you know, I was just reminded of the story. And when you are, there are several candles or several woods are taken together, and they are trying to burn it together. When all of them are together, it burns well. And when they take one wood out of it, and it just the fire quenches. So it's always there. It's always good for all of us to come together and worship our God, and that gives us encouragement. And as we are going to begin the new series on Book of Micah, and God has been so good, and He has been ministering to us in a very special way through the servants of God as we meditated on the Gospel of John. And we are going to begin the Micah from the Old Testament today. I'm sure that God is going to minister to us in a very special way, and we don't know what God is having in store for us for sure, and it will unfold as we continue to meditate on the Book of Micah. So I was just reminded of one particular verse from Micah, and which is very famous verse that all of you know. It is from Micah chapter 6, verse number 8. It says, it reads this way: He has told you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you, but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God. Three things: to do justice, love kindness, walk humbly with your God. So let us follow this cardinal principle that is there in the Book of Micah as we study. So with this thought, I would like to welcome all of you for this morning chapel service, and where Jesus Christ is the center of our worship. And before we go any further, shall we all pause for the moment of prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for this beautiful morning time. And thank you, Lord, for helping us to come together and worship you and adore you and exalt your name. And where two or three gather together, you are there in our midst, O God. And even as we gather together, you are always there in our midst. And O Lord, and even as we begin to worship you and adore you together, O God, and we want your presence and your continuing and ever-abiding presence to be with us, O God. Lord, I pray for the worship team that is going to lead the worship this morning. O Lord, as we worship together, O God, give us the heart to worship you and break all the bondages and break all the hindrances, O God. Lord, I do pray for the scripture reader who is going to read your word and give her the clarity of words. And I pray for your servant and who is going to unpack the word to us, O God, this morning. O Lord, use him mightily among us, O God. As a community, we come before you, and you take control of the entire chapel service as we committed everything in your mighty hand. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. So today, and we have a worship team led by Samson, and the scripture would be read by Sister Bandana, and today's sermon and Dr. Jagannathan will be preaching to us this morning. So shall we all worship God together as Samson and team leads us into worship through songs?
Okay, thank you, sir, for giving us this wonderful time, and good morning to everyone. Indeed, it's a very blessed day that Lord has given to us. As sir has said, walking with God is only the thing that we are having in our life as a believer. So walking with God demands our consistent and our perseverance, bit by bit and heart to heart with God, and even step by step. We may fall down, but still then we depend and we stick our mind with God so that we stand up every day, even if we lost the battle, spiritual battle as well. So this morning, I would like to remind with this song, as we sing along with this song, let us all remind that Lord is the one who gives us strength. Yes, the strength which will, even if the day is marked with suffering, God is the one who gives us strength. So let us bless God and let us praise God with this song. So may I request Sam to project our song.
Thank you. fall, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. When I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name.
Yes, Lord, our gracious Heavenly Father, thank you for the identity you have given to us in you, O Lord. Thank you for choosing us. Thank you for redeeming us from all our sins and trespasses, O God. Thank you for all the blessings, O God. And also at this morning, we surrender ourselves at your cross. God, you strengthen us, you enable us as we are here gathered to listen to your word. God, you teach us your word, the way in which we need to walk, and strengthen us to walk in your ways, O Lord. We commit ourselves in your mighty hand. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, worship team, for helping us to the time of worship. And now we have the scripture portion. It will be read by Sister Vandana. It is from Micah chapter 1, verse 1. So I would like to request Sister Vandana to read the scripture portion for us.
Thank you, sir, for the time. For today, devotional meditation, Micah chapter 1, verse 1. The word of the Lord that came to Micah of Morisseh in the days of Zadam, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, kings of Judah, which he saw concerning Samaria and Jerusalem. Micah, please.
Thank you, Sister Vandana. It is always our privilege to have Dr. Jagannathan with us, and this morning, once again, it's our privilege and it's our honor to have Dr. Jagannathan to share the word of God with us. And I shall hand this time over to Dr. Jagannathan.
Today we are privileged to have the word of God from the book of Micah. Micah is one of the minor prophets, BCE. Four prophets who are from 8th century BCE, two prophets in the northern side of Israel, and two from the southern side. Amos and Hosea. Two from the southern side that are Arise of Jerusalem and Micah. These four are the 8th century prophets. And interestingly, we see this 8th century is a century filled with very, very important activities and events. 8th century was middle of 8th century. We see the rise of the Neo-Assyrian power. If you Tiglath-Pileser the third, he was the one who was overpowering the whole Near East, that is to say Israel, the northern part. It was also the time of prosperity. 8th century was also the time of prosperity, especially in Israel, the northern side. If we look into the book of Amos, and then if we look into the book of Hosea, we see the amount of prosperity that was existing, especially in the upper class people. So 8th century was not a century of poverty. Of course, it was a century of poverty for the poor people, but taken overall, it was a time of prosperity in the prosperity for the northern side. And then we see that this 8th century is also remarkable because of the destruction of Samaria in 722 BC by the Assyrians. And because of the destruction of Samaria, we are now having the group called the Samaritans. The Samaritans are the children born for the mixed marriage between the Assyrians and the people of Samaria. So from 8th century BCE only, we have the new group called the Samaritans. So because of all these things, we see that 8th century is a very important period in the history of Israel. And it was also a time of prosperity and so on. And it was a time when the northern side flourished. And because of the improvement or increase in the riches of the land, we see also a lot of injustice and overpowering of the rich people and so on. So it is at this time that we have the prophet Micah coming somewhere between 737 onwards, maybe till the end of that century. Now the word Micah itself is a combination of three words. You know, me. Me means who. Then ku means like. Then ya, Micah, ya. Ya is actually Yahweh, short form of Yahweh. So it is, the meaning is, who is like Yahweh? It is not an informative question, who is Yahweh like that. It is not like that question, but it is an astonishment. Who is like Yahweh? That is an astonishment. So the name Micah itself expresses the great surprise and astonishment the prophet had with regard to the overpowering power of Yahweh. So who is like Yahweh? This is the meaning of the word. So the whole book is demonstrating the power of Yahweh. The power of Yahweh is demonstrated in different ways. In different ways we see. Then we see that Micah is also from the laboring class. See, we have two prophets in the 8th century in the southern side. One is Isaiah of Jerusalem and Micah. Isaiah of Jerusalem is from the aristocratic family. Actually, aristocratic family means Isaiah of Jerusalem was almost like a priestly family. You see the vision in chapter 6 of Isaiah. Isaiah was in the temple. That means he belongs to the priestly class. And so he was a man of upper class. Whereas Micah was a man of the lower middle class or the laboring class. And he also comes from the very poor rural area that is called Moresheth. Moresheth is a small village situated about 25 miles southwest of Jerusalem. You know, Jerusalem is a city. And for all the menial works of Jerusalem, like cleaning the city, then when the tourists come or when the pilgrims come, working for the pilgrims, everything is done by the small villages that are surrounding Jerusalem. So Jerusalem was filled with rich people. Whereas the villages that are around Jerusalem are filled with the laboring class, and Moresheth is one of the laboring classes, and Micah is representing the lower class. So first and foremost, we see that two prophets from the southern side in the 8th century, that is Isaiah of Jerusalem, and the second prophet is Micah. Isaiah of Jerusalem is from the priestly class, whereas this one, Micah, is from the labor class. So this is what we have with regard to the background. And then we see that the historical situation, if you see this historical situation, Micah prophesied when kings Jotham, Ahaz, Hezekiah, they were ruling in Judah. So Micah's prophetic character spanned over almost some 25 to 30 years. And Micah was also was a prophet during the time of Hezekiah. And Hezekiah was a vigorous ruler who enjoyed the confidence of both priests and prophets. So he was responsible for centralizing worship in Jerusalem. So this is with regard to Hezekiah. Now, if you look into the structure of the book, we see that Micah is book is arranged alternatively. That is to say, one passage dealing with the condemnation and another passage dealing with the salvation. Again, a passage dealing with the condemnation. Again, a passage dealing with the salvation. Then the third set of condemnation, that is doom, and then the third set of salvation. So the message of doom and salvation come alternatively. So the first, they say, the first three chapters are the original messages of Micah. And definitely, Micah was from a labor class. He would not have arranged so thematically all these ideas in a very, very logical manner. Perhaps Micah uttered all these ideas, all these condemnation of doom, everything. A later editor would have reorganized everything, these things in a very, very systematic and literary way. So the touch of an editor is very clear in the book of Mika. And then we see we have first three chapters original messages. These original messages are once again taken by the editor and amplified. So if you want to get the full substance, or you know, we say the juice, or you want to full get the core of the message of Mika, we must concentrate on the first three chapters. So those people who are preaching the first three chapters must pay very much importance to each and every word, because we say that these are the ipsissima verba. Ipsissima verba means the very same words of the prophet. So these words may not be very, 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 very easy to understand, and may not be very plain in meaning. So we have to go back to many commentaries or many Hebrew dictionaries and get the original meaning and then preach this. So the first three chapters are very important. And we see there are the message of doom and salvation coming alternatively and so on. Now, what are the messages? What are the messages in the book of Micah? The first message, as I already told, is though Micah is from the southern side, he is not talking about the Zion tradition or Davidic kingship. You know, very interestingly, the people from the southern side, they always promote Zion tradition. Zion as the dwelling place of Yahweh, then Zion as the chosen place of Yahweh. Zion is the place where all the pilgrims come. So they sing psalms of beauty, narrating the beauty of Zion. All these things are promoting Zion tradition. Whereas Micah is not telling anything about this Zion tradition, because we will see the message later. He is not at all interested in Zion tradition. Whereas Isaiah of Jerusalem speaks here and there about Zion tradition. But secondly, he is not more concentrated on Jerusalem temple also. So he is not very much concentrated about the temple, about the oracle, about the cult. All these things also are taken up by Micah. So the first thing is Micah is not concerned with Zion or Davidic tradition, which is usual for the southern side prophets. But Micah is omitting all those things because he is going to touch something very serious. The second one is Micah is not concerned with the temple also, because he is not a prophet. He is not, whereas Isaiah of Jerusalem is a prophet, is a priest. So he talks much about the temple and so on. So Micah does not talk much about the temple and so on. And then we come to the third point, that is Micah is primarily concerned with the ethical issues. This is a very important point. Micah is concerned very, very much with regard to ethical issues. Sins will definitely lead to judgment. So this is the first theme. Judgment is the theme. Sins will definitely lead to judgment. Any bad action, anything which is not incompatible with our human dignity, incompatible with our Christian dignity, will definitely lead to judgment. So he delivered a bitter oracle against Jerusalem. So he was very much upset because Jerusalem is the chosen city. Jerusalem is the place of God. Jerusalem temple is there. But he sees everywhere corruption. He sees immorality. So he utters an oracle of condemnation against Jerusalem. So the prophet concentrates on the crimes. What are the crimes? Crimes of corrupt officials. You know, corruption. Corrupt officials. Both religious officials and political officials. You must understand, religious officials are also involved in corruption. Today we think that corruption means immediately we think about politicians only. We must also think about the religious corruption. Okay, religious corruptions are there. And then, so he's talking about religious corruption in religious life, corruption in cultic life. And he talks about corruption in also in the political sphere. Then he is talking about the unexemplary life of priests, prophets, and judges. very interestingly, the whole religious life of the Israelites stood on three pillars. Actually, it is four pillars. Four pillars. One is a priest, prophet, judge, and king. So four prophets. Actually, because of the judge, the king character is left away. So three triangular basis for the religious life is priests, prophets, and judges. And all these people are involved in corruption, according to Bika. So all these people are involved in corruption. Religious life of the people of Israel is a big question, big danger. So Micah is uttering a prophecy with a lot of zeal, with a lot of anger, and with a lot of enthusiasm. He cannot but shout at the people. So there are some people who will not be able to control their anger. See, the prophets are very emotional people. You must understand that. Prophets are not insensitive people. Only sensitive people can be prophets. Insensitive people can never be prophets. Insensitive people can never be missionaries. Only sensitive people can become prophets. Sensitive people will become missionaries and so on. So this so much of vigor and enthusiasm and anger and fire was in his speech against these priests, prophets, and judges, and so on. So they were self-serving. You know, today everywhere we go to marriage and all, no? Everywhere, big. This one is self-service. That self-service has already become a pattern for our life. That is, we are all doing service for ourselves. So self-service is not only in marriage reception and other places, in hotels, in buffet and so on, but self-service has become the lifestyle. It's lifestyle for everybody, that we are all serving ourselves only. Self-service. Anything we are doing for others also will have the end or ultimate goal in myself. So we have self-service. So this self-service was very much criticized by Micah. Also, very interestingly, Micah is from the rural side, and so he was very much against these capital cities. You know, two capital cities. Today we have the capital city like Chennai, Mumbai, then Calcutta, Delhi, Bangalore, all these. So to say that I am from Bangalore itself is a pride for many of us. I am from Bangalore, I am from Chennai. That itself is a big pride for us. But these capital cities are liable for more judgment. We must understand that. These capital cities are the places where injustice is harbored, injustice is hatched, and injustice is planned. So we see that these capital cities, at the time of Micah, we have two capital cities. One capital city in the northern side, that is Samaria. Another capital city in the southern side, that is Jerusalem. So he was so much uttering oracles against these two capital cities. So we must, because we must know that Micah is a rural man. Rural man. Today, we see that 90% of the rural areas are totally neglected by the government. And these are poor people, very, very illiterate, very easily cheated with empty promises. Now you see the elections coming, you see the amount of promises that are given to all these people to get the votes. And once you are in power, the next time they will be visiting is the next election only. Next election. So we see the time of floods. We see, for example, Tuticorin, the shooting which took place in Tuticorin. We saw the two merchants who were killed in Tirunelveli district. All these things, how many politicians were there, all these calamities, nobody will be there. So these villages are God-forsaken villages, labeled as God-forsaken, but God never forsakes. They are labeled like that. So we see that Micah is very much against city culture. City culture. And then we have the last one is he was concentrating on social justice. So he says that religious worship without social justice is meaningless. Mika spoke out boldly in defense of the shepherds and poor farmers whose lands were being expropriated by the rich. That is, today you see the amount of land which is plucked by the government from the poor people. You see the northern belt, for example, you have Chhattisgarh, then you have Jharkhand, all these places. The amount of land the tribal people have lost, the fertile land, for whom the politicians have taken and in favor of or to favor the rich people like Ambani and so on. Today in Tamil Nadu also you see the Etivali Chalai, the 8-way road. How much amount of land is going to be confiscated? That land belongs to whom? It belongs to the poor people. For the sake of whom? For the sake of the rich people. Who are going to travel in this road? These are the village people going to travel every day to Chennai in 5 hours from those villages? No. It is all, these are rural people, innocent people, and people who have no land, their lands are, it is same situation. We see that in Micah's time, Micah is condemning the rich people who are plucking, taking away the land of the poor people. So because of all these things, the rich people are condemned, politicians are condemned, religious authorities are condemned, and above all, judges are condemned. But at the end, we see, that is especially in the 7th chapter, we see God is full of forgiveness. So in spite of all these things, Micah has a message of divine forgiveness. That divine forgiveness is not based on any value. Divine forgiveness, when I give to somebody something, I expect something back. But God gives, God is the only person who gives without expectation. And he gives forgiveness, divine forgiveness. That divine forgiveness is completely different from human forgiveness. So he has a message of divine forgiveness. And because of this divine forgiveness, there is hope. Today we have hope to live a better life because we think that God forgives us. So hope is based on forgiveness. So he spoke of the restoration of the temple. He speaks of the salvation of the people. Micah 4 sees the centrality of Yahweh in our life. So this is very important. The centrality of Yahweh. Who is the center of my life? What is the center of my life? This is money the center of my life? Is fame the center of my life? Or is my pleasure the center of my life? What is the center of my life? We have to ask the question. Around that center, we must come round again and again and again. Mika says, especially in 4, 1 to 5 and so on, that universal peace, it can be achieved if Yahweh is the center of the lives of the people, if Yahweh is the center of the life of the people of Israel. So today, we are beginning the study of the book of Mika. Very, very, very inspiring book. And you know, the literary style, I have a lot of things to share, but there is no time. So the literary style, the beautiful literary style of Mika is a disputation speech. What is disputation speech? If you see in some of the films, of Tamil films, you know, you see the Natamai film and all. You see two people in the village, husband and wife, quarrel. So it is not a personal problem. If you come to the Natamai, so the fellows will sit, the old fellows will sit under a banyan tree and the husband and wife will come together there for judgment. So yeah, you start, you will ask the lady and then the lady will say, "Ennatha solradhu, what to say? This man is going here and there and he is having legal relationship with her and I cannot live with him." Then they will ask, "What you are saying?" So like that, they will say, hear both sides, and finally the Natamai will make one judgment.
Okay, you give so much of rupees for this woman and you divorce her and you get married to that woman, some kind of judgment will come. This is called a disputation speech. Now Yahweh is having a dispute with the people of Israel. So he is telling what all he has done for the people of Israel. So the disputation speech, especially in chapter 5 and so on, no, you have very, very beautiful disputation speech. So that is a literary style. Yahweh is quarreling with the people. He is narrating what he has done. And who are the witnesses? Nobody can be witness for Yahweh because all of us are temporarily living. So the witness for Yahweh is the nature, the trees, the mountains, the hills. These are the witnesses. So Yahweh calls them as witnesses to judge against the people. So this disputation speech, this shows the agony of God, the agony of God, God agony which God has towards his people. He is having such amount of anger and such amount of agony towards his people. So today, as we are beginning the reflection on the book of Micah, I would like to say 3 points for a reflection. The concentration on urban culture, that is the first point. The concentration on urban culture. Second point is worship without justice is useless. So our worship, spiritual life, must be coupled with the social justice, concern for the poor, concern for the illiterate, concern for the rural people. Third one is sensitivity. How far I am sensitive to others. The fourth point, you see, the centrality of Yahweh in my life. The centrality of God in my life. Who is the center of my life? Are people center of my life? Is fame the center of my life? Is sex and pleasure the center of my life? So we have to every day ask the question, who is the center of my life? Then the last one is judgment. Judgment, that is, God will definitely judge his people. If we do bad and insist on doing bad and continue on doing bad and without any repentance, without any change, God will definitely judge us. That at the same time, is the opposite, the gift of forgiveness, divine forgiveness, the gift of divine forgiveness, what God offers. If we enjoy that gift of divine forgiveness, definitely our life will be transformed. And then we see, definitely we will have a sort of peace in our lives, and definitely we will have a sort of fullness in our life. So these are the lessons which we need to take from the book of Micah. Those who are preaching the first three chapters must concentrate very much on the words, because the words are very, very pregnant words. That means it's words with full meaning. And then the messages also, overall messages I have given, those messages can be developed. Then we see the structure, condemnation, then we have salvation. Condemnation, salvation, like that. Then Amos was a prophet who was very, very relevant to the people of his time. So we must ask ourselves, to this century, to our people, am I becoming a relevant person? Is my message a relevant message? Is my life a relevant life? Have I made myself relevant for the people who are coming in contact with me? So these must be the questions when you reflect on the book of Micah. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Jagannathan, for the excellent exposition of the book and all helping us to understand from the historical perspective and the social perspective and the economical perspective, and giving us the full background of the prophet Micah. And also helping, highlighting so nicely and what actually the book of Micah is all about. And you talked about the interchangeable, the alternative use of condemnation and salvation, the sin that leads to judgment, the ethical issue that Micah is actually speaking against in relation to the corruption that was existing in the priestly family and the prophetical tradition and also the judge tradition and also the divine forgiveness, and that will bring the transformation in our life. And what is the centrality of our life? And when we come to the reflection, you talked about concentrating on the urban culture, and worship without justice is useless, and sensitivity is very important in our life. And the centrality, having Yahweh as the center of our life, what is the centrality of our life? And finally, the judgment, and that followed by the divine forgiveness. And thank you so much, sir, for explaining the prophet Micah in a limited time in a beautiful way. We are so thankful unto you. And thank you so much for all of you for listening to him. I hope all of you are taking notes and all of you are writing whatever Dr. Jagannathan was saying about the prophet Micah. It's very important for all of us as we study the book of Micah. These informations are very important as we continue to meditate on this particular book. So once again, thank you so much, sir. And still we all pause.
Thank you, sir.
Gracious Lord, Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for speaking to us this morning and helping us to understand the backdrop of Micah in a very detailed manner this morning, O God. And thank you so much for the wisdom and the spirit and the encouragement and the enthusiasm that has come from Dr. Jagannathan. The way he explained the background and the scripture from the book of Micah, it's always very clear to us, O God. And thank you so much for speaking to us this morning. Lord, even as we continue to study and continue to meditate on the prophet Micah, and give us your grace, Lord, even as, Lord, and help us to receive the instruction and help us to do justice and love kindness and walk humbly with you, O God. And help us, O God, not only the hearer of your word, but also the follower of your word. Even as we step into our studies and our work, may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit rest and abide with us both now and forevermore. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much. Thank you, Jagannathan. Have a great day. And do not forget, 19th of March, we are having the webinar. And please, all of you, register for it. Have a great day. Bye-bye. God bless you.